They were women on a mission, in a race against time to record the dying remnants of Ireland's Celtic culture. Marguerite Mespoulet and Madeleine Mignon were already well-travelled women. In their hometown of Paris, they were members of the exclusive traveller society Cercle Autour du Monde, or the Round the World Club. But this was more than just another adventure. They had a job to do, to document Ireland for the first time using colour photography.
I see both Mespoulet and Mignon as very enterprising, unusual, pioneer women in a sense. Nothing fazed them. You know, two French women, you know, taking up their bags and their photo equipment. They weren't professional photographers. But the idea of going from Paris to the west of Ireland on their own, as far as we can work out, developing their photos on the spot, this didn't seem to faze them. I think it would faze lesser mortals, but they were not lesser mortals.
At that time, to leave Paris for the west of Ireland was to change worlds. It was the Paris of the Belle Époque, a flourishing cultural capital that had an influence all over Europe. And they arrive in the west of Ireland, still affected by the Great Famine, that had never recovered from all that tragic history. It really was like changing worlds.
The job of capturing Ireland's fading world was set by French banker and philanthropist Albert Kahn. The women's journey west was part of Kahn's ambitious experiment.
Albert Kahn was quite an extraordinary person. He's stuff of legend. He worked his way up through the banking system, made an absolute fortune in gold and diamonds based on the South African mines. He was shy, private, but at the same time, he was an idealist.
He wanted people to understand how other people and cultures were behaving and living, so that there would be a sympathetic link between French people and other cultures, in such a way that war would become impossible.
As part of Kahn's dream of world harmony, Mespoulet and Mignon arrived in Ireland carrying with them the very latest in camera technology, colour film. And on the 25th of May, 1913, in the Cladda, a village on the outskirts of Galway City, they set up their camera. And Ireland's first colour essay had begun. Marguerite Mespoulet recorded the event in her expedition diary.
A little fishing village at the gates of Galway, which in some strange way reminds one of some villages in Lower Brittany. Although one is first of all struck by the extreme poverty and by the dirt of the inhabitants, some of them live fairly happily, that is to say in relative comfort. But the children there are never any cleaner than the poor little children with ringworm seen here. Among the inhabitants of Cladda and Galway, many are descended from the Spanish colonizers. It is evident that the woman on the left of the group, with her sallow complexion and dark eyes, is not of the same origin as the women with light eyes, clear skin and blonde or black hair with red-gold highlights, which one encounters in towns and in the countryside throughout Ireland.
The Ireland that they came to in 1913 was extremely interesting politically. They came to a place that was bubbling with energy, controversy even. And this is very much reflected in the notebook that they kept while they were going around the country. They mentioned home rule on a number of occasions, so they're very aware of the political background. But what strikes me in the photos, particularly the photos of the west of Ireland, which are quite amazing, is the poverty of the people, and not just poverty. the typhoid outbreak that they were walking into in Connemara was extremely dangerous.
A little to the north of the place where this little house was photographed, people are dying like flies of typhoid fever at present. There is such extreme poverty in the region that weakened bodies die as soon as they catch it. All I saw were stones, brambles and the sky, said a traveler 2 centuries ago. And we could say the same, a poor cottage and stones, stones and more stones. So what can these unfortunate people live on? And yet they passionately love this poor country, this hard soil. At each new conversation, I am asked, do you like Ireland? Isn't she beautiful?
Callum was a very astute person, clearly. He said that he wanted to choose people who were young and intelligent and whose views of the world were not yet formed. He said you always have to travel with your eyes wide open. So he chose people whose eyes were still wide open and who could spot things that possibly older people or maybe people leading slightly more conventional lives couldn't spot.
But Cahan wanted something extra, something more than conventional reports of distant cultures. He wanted a visual record of disappearing worlds, and he acquired the tools following some remarkable developments in French technology. In 1895, audiences in a Paris theatre ran for their lives to escape a runaway locomotive. But they were in no danger, since the fearsome train was nothing more than a projection of the work of 2 brothers, Auguste and Louis Lumière. The cinema was born. And by the end of the first decade of the new century, the brothers achieved what had eluded so many since the dawn of photography. A black and white world was suddenly transformed. The Lumière's autochrome plate marked the dawn of photography in colour. But colour photography opened up opportunities beyond the field of family snapshots.
To show how other cultures live is not an easy task, because you can write, explain, but people do not feel, really, what is the difference. So Albert Kahn used the most modern tools that society of time was offering to him.
The Lumière cinematograph and autochrome colour process gave Albert Kahn his opportunity. He began an ambitious project to create what he called an archive of the planet.
The interesting thing with archives that make them completely different of all collections of photographs in the world is that he was never interested in doing news. He wanted really that photographers and filmmakers come back with pictures of the daily life. So in Ireland, it is the same thing. They are political events that attract attention, but he sent people to collect the pictures of the daily life. So this is the main spirit of Archives of the Planet.
And so it was that in 1913, these young women graduates of the Sorbonne found themselves on the west coast of Ireland. In Galway, they were convinced that, on the outer edge of what was then the British Empire, they would find remnants of what they saw as a great Celtic culture.
One of the reasons why they were so interested in the people of the west of Ireland was because they sensed very strongly that the way of life, their way of life, was about to come to an end. So they talk about costumes that are no longer worn, types of work that are no longer done, and basically it was recording a world that was about to end.
Mm-hmm.
We have very luckily been able to procure a unique specimen of this beautiful costume, which has no longer been worn for the past number of years. The pale skirt was always worn gathered up over the red underskirt. The young girl who posed for this photograph is considered in Galway one of the most perfect types of the Irish Colleen.
When you look at the photos, for example, of the young girl, you have to, I think, almost pinch yourself before you realise that this was a young girl. It's not a painting, it's not artificial, and it wasn't somehow touched up afterwards. The Irish women whose photographs they took were very shy. They stressed this in their notebook. And despite that, they were able somehow to gain their trust.
These women are among the most shy that one could meet. It was necessary to deploy gentleness and cleverness, not to mention other means, jokes and stories, to get them to remain still for 8 or 10 seconds in front of the camera.
I think that's one of the most interesting things about the work they left behind, the relationship that they clearly struck up with these people.
Mespoulet and Mignon were not afraid to wander off the beaten track using various local modes of transport. This may have been their driver of what they called the outside car.
The man who is holding the bridle of the horse is wearing the traditional white jacket in Bonin wool, which is threaded and woven in the villages and often by the man who is wearing it. The young man who is turning his head has the violet blue eyes and long face of the men of the Celtic race. He reminds one of some men in Lower Brittany. To these light carriages are attached lively and strong horses, though they are small, which people come even from England to buy here.
A shift towards industrialization and international trade meant ports like Galway gave access to cheaper, factory-made goods. There were consequences for Ireland's traditional crafts.
Mespoulet and Mignon clearly are very interested in work practices because quite a number of the photos show women weaving, spinning and so on. And we're told in the little commentary that really this isn't going to go on for much longer, that people are now beginning to import cloth and so on. So again, the sense of urgency and nostalgia, but at the same time, a deep realization that these women were working under appalling conditions.
This mother of 7 children lives from this occupation of making fringes for shawls. She's given 3 shillings and 6 pence for making the fringe of 1 shawl. It takes her 3 days to finish it, and she also has to supply the wool. If I didn't have to care for the kids, it might take me just 2 days to do 1 shawl. But there are 7 children in the house.
Il est évident que Marguerite Mespoulet, agrégée d'anglais, reçue première.
It's clear that Marguerite Mespoulet had total command of English, because she established very easy contact with these women, and she translates all the flavour of their speech. For instance, she uses the word mioche, kid, instead of child, or particular expressions that have a peasant ring to them, to show clearly that these are women from a very modest background.
A spinner and her primitive wheel. Before, there was one of these wheels in every cottage in the country. But since the homespun factories were erected in Galway and Athlone, the women preferred to work in the factory and they abandoned their wheels.
But their interests were not confined to women and their work. Mespoulet's diary reflects great respect for Irish rural workers in general, with insight into both their spiritual and creative strength.
Ireland has no coal, but it has turf. And this is what the Irish burn in all the cottages with thatched roofs. Sometimes, in the somber vastness, dotted with springs and small canals, one finds a man armed with a spade, preparing the small piles of turf which must dry in the open air before being transported to the villages. He works alone under the sky, his feet in the water. All that keeps him company is a passing bird or a cloud that scurries in the wind. It is easy to understand how these people of such lively and ardent imagination, living under this sky, in these vast horizons which they love, have been able to create the most beautiful treasury of legends in Europe.
Their view of Ireland is very interesting. They come from a very French tradition that goes back at least to the 16th century, which believed that the closer you live to nature, somehow the better a person you were. There's the myth of the noble savage. And they found this kind of golden age or El Dorado there on the edges of Europe.
When Ireland is not the brilliant emerald land, sparkling and fresh, it is a somber, brown country of bogs on which falls a heavy grey sky. But in May and June, the bog is in flower. The gorse and the white marsh flowers open and make the bog a land of merriment. Unfortunately, the strong wind, which has never left us since our arrival in Ireland, makes our work here very difficult again. The weather is so bad, the wind howling, that these sailors cannot go fishing. These are two characteristic types of men from the coast. They also love Ireland with passion, I would even say with lyricism, because they all talk like poets. The small boy who is on the right of the group is still dressed in a skirt.
It was widely believed that fairies used to come looking for little boys. And in order to fool the fairies, people would dress their little boys in skirts until they were maybe 10 or 12 years old. You wonder when you look at these photos, you know, what became of that little boy? Did he stay in Galway? Did he go to the States like so many other people of the same generation?
The problem of depopulation is as serious for Ireland as it is for France. The young men live for North America. The young women too. When the old people die, the house is abandoned and falls into ruins. There is hardly a village where one does not find several of these depressing skeletons of little grey houses invaded by nettles.
Their vision of Ireland, in my opinion, is a vision that is full of empathy, in which they vigorously defend this country that has experienced so many tragedies. They find the people at the same time so dispossessed but also so worthy. Worthy of escaping this history marked by tragedies, by English domination.
One might ask why we took a photograph of this doorway, but it is a witness to one of the most bizarre episodes in Irish history. It was built, like so many other useless works, during the Great Famine, in the middle of the 19th century, by peasants without work or bread.
For me, in a sense, these photos are about invisible histories. Miss Poulet and Mignon are focusing on things that tourists weren't often interested in or weren't normally interested in.
One can see here just how simple work implements still are in Ireland, even in the East, which is the more developed region of the country.
There's a kind of a questioning in these photos that I don't think you find in other more picture postcard type collections from around the same time.
Two carracks. Only four of these carracks remain in the East. The boatman who brought us here talks to me about Ireland. Like so many others, he is waiting impatiently for home rule. One certainly gets the impression here of living among a people full of hope.
But it was those who had gone before, rather than the living, who continually drew the women to what they called the fields of the dead.
This is the only grave with flowers on it that we have come across. On this grave, which is so poor that it does not even have an inscription, fresh garden flowers and field flowers can be seen woven clumsily in the form of crosses and crowns.
Their summer journey was now coming to an end. Although the women visited Dublin, they took no photographs. Instead, they headed south to County Wicklow and the 6th century ecclesiastical settlement of Glendalough.
We are in a new world, a secret valley between mountains flowering with gorse, where a small stream flows and which opens into two secret lakes. There you find the seven churches of St. Kevin, who took refuge in Glendalough in the 6th century. His followers became so numerous, he had to establish a monastery. This photograph shows the bell tower in all its height and in its beautiful setting of tombs and flowers. Unfortunately, although we were hurriedly trying to take advantage of the bright spells, we could not calm the wind, and the tree on the right is somewhat unclear.
The quality of the writing in the notebooks is quite striking. It's quite poetic, and you sense her love of literature, her appreciation for good writing.
This melancholic country expresses itself especially in its cemeteries, where ruins are falling in on the graves, where between the closely spaced graves, nettles and weeds grow thickly, where death has no companions apart from the moving sky and the wind, but where great sweetness can still be felt.
As Mess Poulet and Mignon's Irish expedition ended and as they headed back to Paris, they were not to know that Ireland's dream of imminent home rule would not come to pass. And they did not know either that Albert Kahn's dream of a world living in harmony would be shattered, and they were going back to a Europe that would soon be convulsed by the horrors of the First World War.
The Great War brought personal tragedy to both Mess Poulet and Mignon. Each lost a brother in the trenches. And the worldwide banking crisis of the 1920s spelt financial ruin for Albert Kahn. But his archives of the planet survive. And this time capsule of an Ireland, now faded, has found a home in the Albert Kahn Museum in Paris.
As an Irish person, I'm very grateful to the banker, Albert Kahn, and to these two women, Mess Poulet and Mignon, who had the extraordinary idea, when you think about it, of heading off to Ireland there in 1913 and taking the kind of photos that no one else took. Recording a world that is now so gone, so distant, so unimaginably past.
You can watch this programme again on the RTE Player along with all the other TV programmes in the Look of the Irish season. And don't forget to look at all the hundreds of photos entered for the Tubberty Show Look of the Irish competition at www.rte.ie/Look of the Irish. Next Friday, Rachel Allen is back with more fail-safe but fabulous recipes at this time.